Hey, in this video, we're going to look at the steps involved in creating and deploying a RESTful web service in Java. We'll also note the tools that we are going to use at each step, so you start to get an understanding of how each tool is used. This lecture will not be too detailed. It'll be an overview to familiarize yourself with all the moving parts. We'll examine each tool in depth in future videos. The first step in writing an application is deciding what your program will accomplish. You decide what services your API will provide, how it will return data, and determine what represents success or failure for each call. We will start with use cases to help us scope what information needs to be exchanged between the client and the server. Now, this step doesn't have a tool per se, but I will provide you with a template to fill out in future videos. This template will help you organize your API because it will help you identify your resources, which are the nouns of your application, and identify which HTTP verbs apply to those resources. Basically, this is the design step. In this step, you'll also want to think about how each resource should be returned. For example, does it make sense to return the resource as XML and JSON, or should it be returned as an image? You'll also need to think about if your resource can be returned as a list or as a single resource. The second step in creating web services is writing the code. This is the fun part, and this is where all the magic happens. You can write Java code in a text file using Notepad or some other simple text editor, but that's really painful. We're going to use an integrated development environment, or IDE, called Eclipse. Now, there are other IDEs you can use, but in 90% of the development world, you either use NetBeans or Eclipse. Eclipse has better ties into Archilean and Wildfly, so we will pick Eclipse for this course. After writing the code in Eclipse, the next step will be to compile it. Now, IDEs can be a blessing and a curse. You can set up your application to compile perfectly in the IDE on your computer, but then everything falls apart when you try to compile on another machine. You might be using slightly different versions of libraries, the wrong version of Java, who knows? Maven is a tool that helps you structure your project, knows how to compile your code, run your unit tests, assemble any artifacts, and maintains a database of dependencies that your project might have. If you're from the C++ world, Maven is kind of like a makefile on steroids. Maven will put all of our code into a special application called a web application. Maven also allows your development process to be repeatable. You should be able to hand off your code to another developer, and with the Maven script, everything should compile. This is imperative in professional Java development, and all programs in this class will use Maven. Once we have our compiled code, we need to find a way to run it. Earlier I mentioned web services are a collection of smaller programs. This means they aren't executed like normal programs. Each smaller program can be the entry point to our application. This means they need to run inside a Java application container. The Java application container is responsible for managing our web service. The Java application server provides many services for our RESTful application. Most importantly, it receives requests from the internet and hands them off to our web service application. The web application container we'll use is Wildfly. Wildfly used to be called JBoss, and it's really JBoss 8. If you have experience with JBoss 7, you will find Wildfly very easy. If not, it's still very easy. Now that we have an application we can run, we need to test it. You should never write code without writing code to test it. We need to know that the code works, and when we add new functionality, we want to make sure that the old functionality doesn't break. That's why the fifth step is to run tests on your web services. The catch is, to run these tests, we need to run the tests in the application container. You might be familiar with running Java code using JUnit. We're going to use something called Archilean. Besides being named after an obscure Men in Black movie reference, Archilean allows us to write JUnit tests that can run within a Java application container. We can make our changes and see immediately that the code runs correctly and we didn't break anything. That's exactly what we need. Archilean will take our application, deploy it to an application container, run the tests, and then remove the application from the application container. In the end, we'll get the test results. Let's finish our discussion of tools by looking at the tools used inside our RESTful web service. For the most part, these will be other APIs that we use within our code. Now, the client layer contains all the client applications that access our RESTful web service. Later in the course, we will write code to call our service from web pages, Android applications, and iOS applications. First, we need to create an API to use. But later, for web pages, we'll access our web services using JavaScript. In Android applications, we'll write Java code to consume our web service. And in iOS, we'll write code in Objective-C using Xcode. We handle requests to the web service in the presentation layer. This is where we will convert resources to the formats that we support. This can be XML, JSON, an image, or anything else that you can think up. You really can return anything from the web service. Well, almost anything. You can't return an elephant. We will also map the request to specific points in our application called endpoints. Ironically, these are the points where smaller web service applications start. An endpoint can be an individual call to perform some action on a resource. We will map these endpoints using the Java API for RESTful services, or JAXRS. Now, JAXRS is just a specification. For now, you can think of it as having a similar relationship as an interface has to a class. It defines how the API should work and what functions it should provide, but it's not an implementation that we can use. We need to use an API that implements the JAXRS specification. In our case, we're going to use RESTeasy for this course. Now, RESTeasy was picked because it comes packaged in Wildfly and it implements the JAXRS 2.0 specification. And, like the name implies, it's pretty easy to use. The resources returned in the RESTful application need to be mapped to data objects. We also need domain-specific logic, or business logic. The domain layer contains the real-world rules for creating, updating, retrieving, and destroying data. We program this layer using Enterprise Java Beans in plain Java code. The domain objects represent our data as how the client views it.
Almost every useful web service application needs to read data and store data. To make our lives easier, we're going to use the Java Persistence API. This is another specification, and the implementation that we're going to use is called Hibernate. These were chosen, again, because they come standard in Wildfly. The data objects in our API represent our data as how the database represents it. So that means, of course, finally we need a database. We will use MySQL because it's free, easy to set up, and it's very popular. Since we're using JPA to abstract most of the database from our view, you could eventually swap out MySQL with any other database that Hibernate supports. All right, that was quite the whirlwind tour of the different tools we will use to create our RESTful API. In the next video, we'll dive in and start using these tools. The first tool we'll cover in depth is Maven.